HarperCollins presents Ruck Me by James Haskell. Read by James Haskell.
I've written another book. I would rather be ashes than dust. I would rather that my spark should burn out in a brilliant blaze than it should be stifled by dry rot. I would rather be a superb meteor, every atom of me in magnificent glow, than a sleepy and permanent planet. The proper function of man is to live, not to exist. I shall not waste my days in trying to prolong them. I shall use my time. Jack London. Foreword. Why another book? I imagine they asked Tolstoy the same question after the publication of War and Peace and Dickens after writing Great Expectations. Well, let's just say my first book, What a Flanker, raised more questions than it answered. And it has absolutely nothing to do with the fact that it sold more copies than expected and the publishers offered me better money to write this one. Who is James Haskell? Why do people think he's a dickhead? Even his wife. Why do some people no longer think he's a dickhead? What is a dickhead anyway? What was it about his typical childhood, the summers in Rangoon, the luge lessons, the making of meat helmets in the spring, that made him the man he's become? Was it his humble schooling that made him the reserved, unassuming adult Haskell we see today? Was it the fluffy world of rugby union that made him the very model of a modern man? To answer these questions, and others like, what percentage of the jokes I come out with over dinner are shit? And why do I spend my time arguing with trolls and trolls' wives on Instagram when I could be having a nice cup of tea and a hobnob with an actual mate in real life? And do I really have the mind of a serial killer? I have taken a trip through the foothills and peaks and the canyons of my life, from the cradle to digging in a quarry in a JCB. Along the way, I've spoken to some of the most important people I know, my mother, my wife, schoolmates, teachers, ex-teammates, ex-coaches, business partners, Kevin the security guard in Waitrose, though he didn't make the cut, in an attempt to make more sense of me. Why the intense shyness in public? Why the almost feminine sensitivity? Why the pathological hatred of confrontation? On reflection, I have to say that most of them had no idea what they were talking about, and at times, I wonder if they weren't in fact recounting the life of someone else entirely, but they gave it a good crack, bless them. To be honest, my publishers wouldn't let me extend the deadline for this book by interviewing some actual Haskell aficionados, or in fact, people who appear to like me. So join me on an epic adventure of discovery like no other. A Haskovery, if you will. You will laugh. You will weep. You might still think I'm a dickhead at the end of it. Whatever you think, I will keep bouncing back and most definitely have the last laugh. Chapter 1. I, Dickhead. Paul Doran Jones, best friend and England teammate. Why do people think James is going to be a dickhead? Because he is. Ollie Phillips, Stade Francais teammate. It's true, when people find out I'm mates with Hask, they roll their eyes and say, isn't he a dickhead? And I think some of his Stade Francais teammates thought he was a dickhead at the beginning. Fair enough, to be honest. Hask is an expressive person who wins people over with his brashness and crass wit. Or at least, that's normally his approach in England. But he didn't speak French, apart from rude words. So when he first walked into the change room and some of his teammates started shouting, fucking hell, it's Haskell, fucking roast beef, it's the little English gay, he started calling them all wankers and telling them to suck his cock. Soos my beat, as every naughty schoolboy will know. Most people in that situation would be shy and timid, but he went the other way completely. What kind of person walks in on their first day of work in a foreign country and starts abusing his colleagues? James Haskell, that's who. Remember, he'd just left Wasps, his childhood club, and this was the first time he played abroad. He'd taken a big risk by moving to Stade because most people thought it would put his England career in jeopardy. He'd just broken up with his first long-term missus. His life was pretty complicated. But he didn't seem to give a shit. And once his teammates got over the shock of his massive English bloke turning up every morning and slagging them all off, they learned to love him. He won their respect by training hard, being the most professional member of the team, and delivering in games. It was clear that he really wanted the club to do well. And they soon began to see past the brashness and realise that he was actually a really good lad. Soon, if Hass wasn't abusing them, they'd be disappointed. That was part of his charm. Thanks, lads. What a way to start this book off. Two of your best mates confirm what most people suspected, that I'm a bit of a dickhead. But to be fair, I dragged them into this. And as Jules said to Vincent in Pulp Fiction, if my answers frighten you, then should cease asking scary questions. More on my time in France a bit later, but what readers need to know for now is that I've never really fitted in and always been a bit of a wrong'un, at least in some people's eyes. Back in school, I was never particularly popular. I divided opinion, was probably liked and disliked in equal measure. I know what you're thinking, Marmite. I should have that word chiselled into my headstone. Here lies James Marmite Haskell. They loved him or hated him. I describe myself as anti-cool, especially at Wellington College, which I joined when I was 13. I had good friends, but I was never one of those kids who was liked by everyone, from the geeks and the alternative kids to the jocks. Plenty of my current friends were those super cool kids liked by everyone, invited to all the parties. That was certainly not me. Now, I finally know my value and spend time with people who enjoy my company. But when you're at school, it doesn't work like that. You're thrown into the mix and it's sink or swim. I was outspoken, had a sharp tongue, which some people couldn't hack. If someone had a go at me, I never really had the self-restraint not to give it back, whether they were older or younger. That can make things a little difficult for you when you are young. Saying that, some people still can't hack it now. For most of my teenage years, there was nothing cool about me. I don't mean that in a let's be humble way. I was honestly like Carlton from The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Until I was 15, my mum laid my clothes out for me to wear to places, and they were not cool clothes. They were jeans with pleats ironed in and jumpers that more often than not matched my younger brothers. If you saw me back in the day, you would have earmarked me as someone who was going to be a permanent virgin. My mum would also encourage me to comb my hair into a side parting so I looked like one of Bill Gates' mates. I had no concept of fashion. Many, including my wife Chloe, would argue that fashion is a concept I'm still to wrap my head round. I never read magazines or knew what cool was. The standard stuff that all kids had. Stussy tops, naff-naff jackets, the t-shirts that changed colour when they warmed up, and jeans that didn't make you look like a paedophile. I missed out on. I didn't even realise I was that uncool, I just had very little self-awareness. When I needed new shoes, for example, I was whisked straight off to Clark's to get the most basic shoes known to man. The only highlight of the trip being you got to put your foot in that electric measuring device, which was definitely the best part about the trip, as the shoes looked correctional at best. Sadly, after about age 10, my feet were too big for the machine, so I had them manually measured by some old harridan who hated me. My shoe game was rubbish, but made even worse by me having clown feet at an early age. If I did spot someone wearing cool shoes, I'd say to my mum, "Can I have them? Please, please, mum?" And she would say, "No, you're getting these Dunlop trainers instead. It's what the school recommends." So for most of my life, all I rocked with was a pair of green flashes. The irony is that they are now actually cool to wear and I'm wearing what's not cool. I wasn't into music, like most teenagers. I certainly didn't buy the NME, listen to the latest indie bands, or go to gigs. I was, to use an old-fashioned phrase, a bit of a square. When I first arrived at Wellington, I tried smoking and drinking with the cool kids, but I knocked all that on the head when I started taking rugby seriously. Wellington traditionally had a reputation as a top rugby school, but back then, the new headmaster was what you might call a progressive, in that he thought the school needed to step away from its old ways and become a much more academic force, rather than a place for meathead rugby players. Instead of keeping what was good about the school, he decided that focusing on athletic pursuits was a bit vulgar, so he would underplay that side of things while overplaying everything else. He was constantly trying to deflect from sport to more niche pursuits, presumably to be more inclusive and not upset the Dungeons & Dragons players and the origamists. Wellington back in the day was not the highly regarded academic force it is today. It was only under the stewardship of the great Anthony Seldon that it was transformed from middle-of-the-road public school to one of the best schools in the country. The very fact they let me in all those years ago should tell you everything. To give you an example of this emphasis away from sport, we used to have a full school assembly with 800 students, including staff, every Monday morning, in which the then headmaster got the various team captains to talk about their latest results. The captain of the a cappella team, the captain of the mime team, the captain of the basket weaving team. Basically, any other sport or club that the school was not known for was asked to give a quick match report. And if there was any time left over, they might let the rugby captain say a word or two. But more often than not, the headmaster would say, "That's all we have time for," and we can hear about the rugby team next time. Down the years, Wellington had become a bit like an American college, where the primary school sports team, rugby in our case, American football in the USA, sort of did what it liked as long as it won. Jonty Driver, the headmaster in my first year, was proper old school and loved his sport. If you could play rugby, you got away with anything. A lot of the teachers hated that. So when the new head came in, it caused a bit of a revolt, which passed down to the pupils. No longer were the rugby players afforded any leniencies or special privileges. In fact, it went the other way. Nerds, rebels, and liberals were in, jocks were out. Surprisingly, I was quite academic. Yes, I got up to mischief, but it wasn't really jock stuff. It was just what most boys got up to, whatever kind of school they went to. It's not like we were standing around in corridors in lettered varsity jackets, pushing nerds into lockers, or flushing a chess kid's head down the toilet. It was just commoner garden mucking about, like throwing water balloons out of windows on each other, tripping each other up, smashing books out of kids' hands, or my favourite, which took place when leaving the dining room. We would fill plastic cups up with water and then turn them upside down on our trays, thus sticking them in place due to the water and air seal. We would then put them on a conveyor belt that would disappear through a hatch into the kitchen. You would wait outside as some unwitting kitchen staff would, without thinking, yank the cup off the tray to put it in the bin and get soaked. You would then hear this scream and a, "Fuck you, you little pricks!" And more often than not, this irate pot washer would come storming out to find the culprits as we ran off laughing as if it was the greatest thing ever. To be fair, it does sound like a dick thing to do, but they fell for it every single day. So at some point, you have to ask yourself, who was really to blame? Paul Doran Jones. Not a jock. That's utter bullshit. James paints this picture of himself as a self-effacing schoolboy, quiet, a bit of an intellectual. Some of that rings true, in that he was articulate, studious, and brighter than some people gave him credit for, but he was also larger than life, even called himself the Beanock, the big name on campus. He was a man-sized unit at the age of 15, already a rugby god. He had his own personal trainer, for Christ's sake. The only time James would tone down his jockness was when he was trying to create an in with one of the girls, in which case he'd suddenly turn into Oz from American Pie, the lacrosse star who joins the school choir in a bid to get laid. The reason James liked and still likes to make out he wasn't a jock and was really a sensitive soul is to further his cause in life. Okay, so Dozer thinks I was a jock. He might be right up to a point. I don't ever remember calling myself Beanock, but I do remember Dozer describing himself as the BLT on more than one occasion. In case you haven't read What a Flanker or listened to an expertly narrated audiobook by myself, BLT stands for Big, Lean and Tanned. So it was the Beanock and BLT doing bits with the ladies. With a duo like that, it's a wonder we didn't have our own TV show. If I'm Oz, then Dozer is Finch from American Pie. He'd hit you with some sophisticated chat and then bang your mum. Actually, now is probably a good time to tell you about the first time I met Dozer, or Paul, as he's known these days, because it'll be popping up a lot in this book, usually to contradict me, as has already become apparent. Having not really given much of a shit about rugby for many years, once I realised I was pretty good at it and could maybe become a professional player, I took it far too seriously. Playing for Wellington's first 15 seemed like the greatest thing a boy could possibly do, so pre-seasons had a very intense vibe. That was the time to put your stake in the ground, make a position your own. Even though the headmaster may have tried to detract from the rugby team, all the coolest and most popular people in school during my first couple of years were in the rugby team. The whole school would turn out for a game, chant and dress up. These guys were heroes, and certainly the people I was inspired to be like. So when it was our time to try out for the first 15 as members of the lower six, we were all fired up. This was our big moment. Picture the scene. All these young bucks, myself included, and the previous year's players, now the senior statesmen, all getting our boots on by the side of the pitch. There was nervous energy in the air. The odd bit of chat, but also that overriding atmosphere of fear that you always have before a trial or a big session. What did the coach have planned? Would we do well? Would we make the cut? This was make it or break it time, at least in our small-minded world. Ken Hopkins was the king, the man to impress. He was the architect of so many unbeaten seasons, a legend on the school coaching circuit who had harvested some of the best talent in the country. He was the man we all needed to impress. This Welsh wizard could make you a star, or not. I never spoke to Ken for my first 3 years at school. I was too scared. He had an aura about him. Everyone knew he was Wellington College's first 15 coach and one of the most successful ever. He used to just give you a nod, never a smile when you passed him, and walk on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.